Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom. Selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera bagi kita. Pak Hermawan, Founder and Executive Chairman of MarkPlus, Honorable Speakers, Distinguished Ladies and Gentlemen. Well, one of the biggest problem for the SMEs is how to promote, how to sell. Basically, it's how the whole marketing concept implemented, such as market, what we call it, marketing mix, etc. So that's a very good idea to mix together entrepreneurs and the marketing back-to-back, as just mentioned by Pak Hermawan. A very good morning to you all, and thank you for your introduction, Pak Hermawan. Let me first of all welcome you to Jakarta for those who have traveled from near and far. Allow me to also congratulate MarkPlus and the Indonesia Marketing Association for hosting the second ASEAN Marketing Summit. I tend to believe that as the largest economy in Southeast Asia, the host country to the ASEAN Secretariat and the host to tens of ambassadors to ASEAN, Indonesia is the right place to hold this event. Therefore, I would like to convey my sincere appreciation to the organizer and sponsors for holding this summit in Jakarta, the diplomatic capital of ASEAN. I'm really honored to be invited to this important summit to deliver my speech about ASEAN. This is especially the case. I just attended a series of ASEAN summits last week in Vientiane, Laos, PDR, where I could observe firsthand the strong resolve of ASEAN leaders and leaders of ASEAN dialogue partners to make the economic integration project in ASEAN and beyond works well to benefit all, from large companies to micro, small and medium enterprises, to youth and women entrepreneurs, small farmers and fishermen alike. But what do we know about ASEAN? Why ASEAN seems important that we gather here to talk about tapping on the potentials of ASEAN markets? Ladies and gentlemen, ASEAN has become a key player not only in Asia, but also in the world. Two decades ago or so, I heard people talking about AFTA, which was being interpreted jokingly to mean a grievous thing after. I believe it reflects the frustration in the past that ASEAN had been slow in making economic progress compared to, say, the European Union or the North American Free Trade Area. But through a long process of building understandings amongst its 10 countries with different political, economic, and social backgrounds, ASEAN managed to not only stay afloat but also emerge as an economically attractive regional grouping. ASEAN's combined GDP stood at $2.43 trillion in 2015, reaffirming the region's position as a global growth center. ASEAN's real GDP grew at a robust rate of 4.7% in 2015, amidst challenging global uncertainties we have been experiencing for 4 or 5 years now. It is projected that the ASEAN's economic outlook will remain resilient at 4.5% in 2016, although external headwinds are expected to weigh on growth prospects. And this is underpinned by strong public and private consumptions, strong infrastructure spending, and strong fiscal policy, before the growth accelerating to 4.8% in 2017. ASEAN's merchandise trade in 2015 reached $2.28 trillion, with intra-regional trade accounting for 24% of the total merchandise, or $445 billion. In terms of investment, ASEAN witnessed FDI inflows of $120 billion in 2015. With the services sector as the largest contributor at 62.5%. We also noted that 18.5% of FDI inflows, or $22.1 billion, are intra-ASEAN FDI inflows, indicating that ASEAN countries invest more in each other company, in each other economy, as a testament of a strong economic prospect of the region. ASEAN leaders are not complacent in looking at ASEAN economic achievements these days. After the attainment of the ASEAN Economic Community by the end of 2015, leaders are now working on ways to further improve economic integration initiative by adopting the ASEAN Economic Community Blueprint 2025. The main focus of the blueprint is on non-tariff barriers, policy adjustment at the national level, competitiveness, innovation, digital economy, national and regional connectivity, economic resilience, SMEs, and global supply chain. Therefore, it's emphasized that by 2025, ASEAN Economic Community will have the following characteristics. Clearly, ASEAN Economic Community is not an end in itself. It is a process of becoming, and ASEAN leaders are clear on one thing, that is, the integration process should stay relevant to the advancement of science, technology, and innovation, to the evolving needs of business to adapt and adjust the new realities, to the need of addressing income inequalities, and to the call for a modern economy. Peeling the onion a little bit, ASEAN has been active in making the best of its regional FTAs with its six partners, by which we deepened and expanded the regional value chains that are centered on ASEAN. One survey by the ASEAN Development Bank suggested that East Asia scores much higher than Central Asia, South Asia, and Pacific in terms of production integration, final goods integration, services integration, and labor integration. All of this is made possible by the ASEAN economic integration and ASEAN's integration with its partners in the greater East Asia. To further deepen and expand the regional supply chain, ASEAN member states and its six FTA partners launched in 2012 a negotiation toward a regional comprehensive economic partnership, or RCEP agreement. The negotiation has completed its 14th round last August, and the negotiators were instructed to accelerate the negotiation toward its swift conclusion. Once put in place, the RCEP will become a game changer to the global trade. RCEP potentially includes 3.4 billion people, or around 45% of the world's population. RCEP's combined GDP was recorded at $22.4 trillion, or 30.6% of world's GDP in 2015. With continued growth, particularly in China, India, and Indonesia, we could anticipate that by 2050, the combined GDP of RCEP countries will grow to over $100 trillion, roughly double the projected size of TPP economies. And at the heart of all this development is Indonesia, the largest economy in ASEAN. Indonesia has an attractive value proposition. Over two decades, improvement in labor productivity, which is largely from specific sectors rather than a general shift out of agriculture, have accounted for more than 60% of the country's economic growth. And unlike typical ASEAN tiger economies, Indonesia's growth is more a result of growing consumption rather than exports or manufacturing. This trend has been supported by rapid urbanization. It is predicted that by 2030, Indonesia will have added 90 million people to its consuming class. One survey suggested that by 2030 there will be 135 million members of the consuming class in Indonesia. 71% of the population lives in cities, producing 86% of GDP. 113 million skilled workers are needed to run the economy, and there will be $1.8 trillion market opportunities in consumer services, agriculture and fisheries, resources, and education. Ladies and gentlemen, why do I bring Indonesia into this picture? Roughly 250 million out of 600 million people in ASEAN are Indonesians. And if you consider ASEAN is diverse, so is Indonesia, with more than 350 ethnic groups and more than 700 local dialects spoken on its more than 17,000 islands. And if you wish to get some tips to market your goods or services or to invest in ASEAN, you can learn from doing business with an Indonesian and in Indonesia. First, be aware of deep cultural and religious factors. Islamic values are dominant in Indonesia, Malaysia, and Brunei Darussalam, while Confucian values are dominant in Singapore and Vietnam. Latin influences are prevalent in the Philippines, while Buddhism and Hinduism govern much of social practices in Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Thailand. Second, honor the hierarchy and respect formality. There is a great respect for hierarchy in ASEAN's countries, and there is an unwritten protocol to follow depending on your position. People also tend to be formal at first, until permission is handed for more casual familiarity in interactions. Third, pay attention to business cards. It is highly advisable that you carry business cards which serve as mini resume about you and your company. Upon exchange, it is customary to absorb all the details of the card you receive and avoid putting it away until the meeting is adjourned. And fourth, consider the need for consensus. People usually work more from a sense of collective rather than individual responsibility. Hence, collective responsibility entails consensual decision making, which may take longer to arrive at a decision than otherwise. But make sure that a decision is put in clear wordings, as many people in this region communicate in subtler, indirect ways that can be sometimes difficult to understand. This is a typical Japanese culture, actually. This is not to say that ASEAN is a traditional economy where only old ways of doing business persist. On the contrary, ASEAN is an evolving community where local wisdoms blend with modern ways of advancing business. Such a blend has allowed ASEAN to be known for its resilience and serve as a success story for regionalism at the time when resentments toward regional integrations are on the rise in other parts of the world. We understand that we need to run the economy in an efficient way so as to enable us to compete both in the domestic markets as well as regional and global markets. We believe that improving the efficiency of the economy will not only enhance our competitiveness in view of stiffer competition at the global stage, but also will allow our farmers, fishermen, young and women entrepreneurs, and our middle class in general to flourish and contribute better to the economy. We are working on better managing our markets. Neither ASEAN nor Indonesia is closing doors to foreign trade and investment. Rather, we opt for the right policy mix where our people can equally benefit from the opening of our economy while we continue integrating ourselves with the global market. To sum up, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to offer 2 points from my speech. First, ASEAN is unique. You could not compare it with other regional groupings. ASEAN is a platform where a developed economy working together with newly emerging economies to assist developing and the least developed economies to grow together. And I'm sure that you could see the opportunities there to market your goods and services or invest in ASEAN and find your partners for growth. And second, talking about partnering, Indonesia is your best choice in ASEAN. This is a country of critical mass for ASEAN. This is an economy with humongous opportunities, a true miniature of ASEAN, if you like. I myself have a strong business background, and I can assert with the highest degree of confidence that Indonesia is where the future of ASEAN lays. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Pak. Please stay here for a moment, Pak.